Hello everyone, my name's Claire, and this is the last video in our series all about opera. Today, we're going to find out about the different kinds of people that work in opera and what their jobs involve.
Okay!
You might be surprised to know that not everyone involved in opera sings or plays an instrument. There's a huge number of people needed to bring an opera production together.
Oh!
Often doing things you can't even see.
Wow!
Maybe something they do is the kind of thing you would like to do when you're older. We already met some of the key people in opera. Can you remember who any of them were? We met a singer, a librettist, that's the one who writes the story, a composer, the one who writes the music, a director, and a dancer. Even though all these people are very important, there are hundreds more people needed to make an opera. We're going to take a look at some of the people who work behind the scenes to make it all happen. Do you remember our fourth video where we learned about the set? Well, between the set, the costumes, and the props, there are loads of different jobs. There's the costume department, which has tailors and drapers, a milliner just to make hats, someone in charge of shoes, someone in charge of jewellery, a whole wigs and makeup department, and a head of armoury.
Huh?
That's right, someone's entire job is dedicated solely to making fake weapons for the stage.
Huh.
Let's meet a couple of people from opera houses throughout the UK who work in some of these departments.
Sometimes I start out not really knowing how I'm going to make something, and it's just nutting it out and working out and playing with things, and not many people get the chance to do that, I think. I always liked making things. I had no idea how I was going to make a living from making something. I could picture myself being in a room where I had all my materials around me and all the things that I need for making that, and I would make whatever it was I was making all day. And amazingly, that's what I've ended up doing.
We have really close relationships with our artists because we spend the most time with them before a show. Because they're so anxious and nervous before they go on stage, and it's such an intimate process, they share all their problems with us and their worries. So our relationships with the artists are very interpersonal as well as professional. Our work is very much a live art, which is created on the spot. It's still a very dexterous skill, and it's still painting on people, so I think if you've got that painterly skill, then you could be a makeup artist, and it's still a form of art.
As a member of the Armoury department, you need to be able to turn your hand to a vast number of skills. You need to be able to work on the bench, you have to work rehearsals, and you have to be able to work stage. For William Tell, I'm currently creating the crossbows, although orchestrating the management of the Armoury for the whole performance. So we have over 70 people to kit out with Armoury. That will include individual items such as belts, holsters, down to guns, rifles. We also have blank firing guns in the performance, so we will be teaching and training the performers.
The main challenges of being an armourer, at least from the experience I've had, is that with a versatile set of skills come a variety of requests. So if you're kind of a jack of all, you never really know what's going to be thrown at you, and it really keeps you on your toes, because you have to be able to turn your hand at pretty much anything, really. And although that might be a challenge, it's a real joy as well.
Hi there, I'm Lorna Price. I'm the head of costume for Scottish Opera. How did I get into working with costume? I've been sewing and making clothes since about the age of 9. When I was 11, I went with my school to see a production of Shakespeare's Twelfth Night and absolutely fell in love with the theatre. When I finished my A-levels, I decided to train as a wigs and hair and makeup artist. During my training, I was given the opportunity to work at the local theatre. An opera company were touring a production and needed extra hands to help the wigs and hair team. Of course, I jumped at the chance. I will admit it was absolutely terrifying to be doing proper work, but also just amazing to be backstage in a theatre working alongside professionals. I don't think I had ever been to an opera before. I don't think I'd even listened to one all the way through, but it was a life-changing experience for me. Overnight, I became aware of a whole department devoted to wonderful costumes. Despite my addiction to sewing, I'd never realised that there were jobs making costumes. It was certainly never a career opportunity that was discussed at school, so to be surrounded with a chorus in big skirts and bum rolls and corsets was absolutely a moment of, hey, wow, can I do this? What's the most complicated costume I've ever made? Well, the easy answer is that any costume can be complicated. It all depends on what the performer is required to do in the staging. You can make a really impressive and very beautiful 18th century sack back gown, but all the singer has to do is walk across the stage. So as long as they're comfortable and can most importantly sing in the costume is successful and has been relatively easy to produce. On the other hand, you can have a simple 1940s dress that the singer has to run up a flight of stairs in, then sing, and then jump out of a window. I think one of the most complicated costumes that I've made was for a physical theatre performer who had to turn a cartwheel across a kitchen table. This is not a problem in tracksuit bottoms, but her costume for the piece was a close-fitting 1950s wiggle dress. You can just about walk in a wiggle dress, hence the name, so cartwheels were never really going to be an option. Changing the design of the costume also turned out not to be an option, so I had to devise a secret panel behind a split in the centre back of the skirt that enabled her to perform without ripping her dress. I can honestly say that of all the different forms of theatre that I've been involved in, opera singers quite definitely get the best costumes.
So if those people work in the costume department, what about the props and the set? This is where we find the model makers, the prop makers, master carpenters and master electricians, and the head of scenic art. And sometimes there's someone just in charge of dyeing fabric. Let's meet some of them.
So it went through different incarnations, but originally it was if I show you the prop, to make this light up with some movement, as if there was something inside living. So we tried lots of different versions and eventually came up with the insides that look a little bit like this, which is just an awful lot of LEDs with some electronics and a battery pack underneath. And so by manipulating these at different speeds and different intensities, we get the character of the bottle, it comes to life. About a week before opening night, we got it into a proper bottle that was all frosted, and then it came to life. The singers on stage, it was their first time seeing it and our first time interacting with them. And so we were just playing away with different things and trying to get it to talk and have a life, really. And that was quite a magical moment when all that came together, all the sweat and tears of putting this thing together, that was quite nice.
My name's Kelvin. I'm the head scenic artist at Scottish Opera. And this is the paint workshop we're in. An unusual space, shall we say.
So we realized that they had many strengths here at Scottish Opera in costumes and many things, but one of the biggest strengths was the scenic painting.
With this particular cloth, we've had to draw out before, so we can separate areas that need dyed, areas that need painted. In this case, because there's a perspective involved, we have to have that fairly correct, otherwise it's going to look odd.
This artwork is disappearing because a lot of people say, well, let's print things, but printing doesn't give you that. Even if you enlarge things, you will still see the pixels.
And also you don't have the same color, you don't have the same pigment, so it doesn't react well to the light, it doesn't, you know, it's like fake is fake.
And you know that by using his talent that You ask him to go there and he will go there because he's so knowledgeable, he has so much experience.
Forget about all the artistry, if that's the right word, that goes into it, and just enjoy the music and the fun.
So far, all the people we've talked about make things in preparation for when the opera starts running. But what about all the people who keep the show rolling on performance night? Here, we meet the people who work the flies. No, not those flies. These flies are big ropes that control how all of the scenery moves around on stage in an opera.
He's going in with the gauze. The gauze goes in, and then there's a 5-minute scene, the Hungarian march scene with all of the soldiers from across Europe And then you've got John going in on the full black, and then shortly following that is be the third green light, and that's when we will do our scene change.
Go.
The flies we just saw were done by hand, but sometimes these are controlled digitally. Another really important part of the performance is the lighting. The lighting isn't just used so that you can see the people on stage, or find your way to the toilet in the interval, but it can also show you what the feel of a particular scene is. Let's hear more about it.
Why do you need lights at a theatre?
Well, you need lights for lots of different reasons. I mean, you need to be able to see people's faces. You need to be able to see people's full bodies, all their movement, the different colours that you use to convey different emotions or to tell different stories.
This is the backdrop for the show, basically. It is, it's lit in such a way that it takes on a different persona depending on what, where it's lit from and what colour it's lit, because it has to represent sort of like a garden, sort of like an Eden-like facade, and then at another point it has to represent hell, so they light it with sort of fiery reds and things, and it just does a really, really good about face. It's just really, really clever.
You can use it in a way you can't in film or television, because in film or television there's a limit to how red something can be. But in the theatre, if you use physical red paint and then start throwing red light on it, you can get intense reds that the camera could not pick up.
Now, more than ever, video has also started to be used in opera, and some opera houses have even started to hire people who do something called projection mapping. Do any of you know what projection mapping is? Projection mapping? It's where you digitally map the shape of a building and then project a video onto it. It means that even if a building, or in the case of an opera, a stage, is complicated with lots of nooks and crannies, you can project something onto it without the image being distorted. Special effects aren't just limited to videos either. Sometimes an opera production might need special effects like a smoke machine or even fire. Let's take a look at some of these special effects in action.
Alex Q330, fly Q3, surtitle screen out, propeller and main flames.
Go.
Stand by please, let's cues 332 to 336, pit blackout and restore.
Pretty exciting! Now, if you were really concentrating, you might have seen right at the beginning of that clip that there were words above the stage while the singer was singing. These are called surtitles. Can you guess what the surtitles are? Well, they're basically a translation of the text in the opera, or in other words, the libretto. Operas have been written in many different languages, and the surtitles are always in the native language of the audience. So, if Scottish opera perform Puccini's Tosca, which is sung in Italian, the surtitles will be in English. But if an opera house in France puts on Dido and Aeneas, which is sung in English, then they'll have French surtitles, so that the audience can still understand. Sometimes, opera houses even have surtitles if the opera is written in the same language, because it helps people to catch all the words, even if the singers are singing their fancy coloratura. And it also means that people who are hearing impaired can still enjoy the opera too. The surtitlist follows the score along with the orchestra and has to make sure to press the button at just the right time in order to keep the surtitles in time with the singer. Now, I'm a singer, but when I was at college, I did the surtitles for opera productions, and it's quite a scary job. Let's see a surtitler in action. Now, we've already mentioned a lot of different things that happen in opera. But how do all these different elements come together at the right time? Well, there is someone very important who helps with that, and they're called the stage manager.
Everything you see that happens technically in a performance is cued by the deputy stage manager. You've got 2 minutes left of the scene change. You have to be the kind of person who thrives on high pressure. I love it, and I love it because of the possibility that things can go wrong, and I love the challenge of having to respond quickly to things going wrong. And it's not for the faint-hearted.
Opera performances begin, there's a technical crew who makes sure the set is in the theatre and all the technical gear is working. This is called the get-in. And when the show is finished and they take the gear away, that's called the get-out. Some opera houses might have 6 to 10 operas a year where they have to do a get-in and a get-out. But for the touring operas, they have to do it every other night. In fact, in some countries like Germany, instead of showing one opera for a few months and then moving on to a different opera, they have a few different operas on rotation all the time. So every night they have to do a get out for one opera set and a get in for another opera set, which is needed for the next day. Let's watch a time lapse of our friends from Scottish Opera doing a complicated get in with lots of lighting to check.
Thank you.
Before we say goodbye, there is one group of people that you can't see from the stage that we haven't talked about at all in this video. Can you guess who it is? It's the orchestral musicians. Now we're going to meet the person who helps the orchestra to play together, and then when the singers join them, helps all of them perform together as a team. It's the conductor. We are really lucky because Holly Matheson, a fantastic conductor based in Glasgow, is going to round off this video by talking all about what it's like bringing the stage, the musicians, and the music all together.
Yay! I've been working in opera for about 20 years, and what I really love about it is knowing that the music we make is helping to tell the story and keep the energy and emotion going, just like a soundtrack on a film. To do that, we study the score and the libretto, so the music and the words, for a really long time beforehand so that we know the story deeply. But we also listen to the director in rehearsal to learn how they want to tell the story, what movements and gestures on stage they want to match with a piece of music, and which underlying emotions they want brought out at any given point in the opera. The musicians and I work down in the orchestra pit, which is like a big room under the stage with an opening at the top so that the singers and I can see each other. And depending where you're sitting in the audience, you might be able to look down and see us playing too. Conducting opera is a bit different from conducting normal concerts on a concert hall stage because you share the job of pacing the performance with the singers. In every cast, they will sing it slightly differently. But even the same cast on different nights will sing a slightly different tempo or take corners differently. So it's more reactive and collaborative than most concert conducting. Sometimes that can be terrifying because you can't always predict what's going to happen and you can't control things as well as you'd like. If a singer forgets their line or their costume gets stuck on a piece of scenery, or someone forgets to come on stage completely, I have to think very quickly about what to do with the music so that it still feels logical and the audience don't notice a problem in the storytelling. The singers sometimes feel very far away up there on stage, and sometimes they have trouble hearing the orchestra because of the stage in between them and the orchestra musicians playing. So they're very reliant on me visually to help keep them in time. And also sometimes we use speakers to relay the sound up from the orchestra pit into the wings on the side of the stage, which helps them hear us. To help with some of those ensemble issues, often there's a second conductor, a chorus conductor or an assistant conductor. They will conduct any music that happens off stage in separate spaces, which happens often in opera. And sometimes they will stand in the wings and relay my beat to the singers, so that when I'm not in the direct line of sight or the singer's angling off stage in some way, they can still keep in time. I've done that job many times myself. In fact, it's how most of us start out conducting opera. And often there'll be a TV monitor with a direct feed from the orchestra pit so that the offstage conductor can see what the main conductor is doing and relay the beat precisely. I really love making things. So if I wasn't conducting the orchestra, I'd probably be building the sets or sewing the costumes.
That was some really interesting stuff. Thanks, Holly. And a big thanks to our friends from Scottish Opera too. That brings us to the end of Dunedin Consort's video series. I hope you had fun and learned some cool new things about the magical world of opera. If you want to find out more, you can follow the links in the description to see the clips that we've shown you through the series in full. That's bye from me, and bye from the whole Dunedin Consort team.